Welcome back to the Azure Essential Show. I'm your host, Jacob Bendfeldt. Joining me again today are Vijay Mital, Corporate Vice President and Chief AI Transformation Advisor at Microsoft Research, and Uli Homann, Corporate Vice President and Distinguished Architect in the Cloud and AI Business at Microsoft. In this episode, which is part of our series on Essential AI for Businesses, we're talking about copilots as universal vehicles for breaking processes and discipline cycles. So welcome, Uli. Welcome, Vijay. We discussed earlier how businesses led by radical product innovation requires breaking down traditional silos in which people operate today. I mean, this means silos of applications, silos of processes, and even disciplines and roles. So in this session, we will focus on how copilots and the Azure Copilot stack can support this. Uli, first question here to you.
Yeah, of course. Pleasure. So I mentioned this in the previous session where we are really looking at a new user interface paradigm. And when we say that, people will say, what do you mean? We moved from character-based screens to graphical user interfaces. Now we are moving to natural user interfaces, the way I call it. So that's one dimension. We are now effectively going to talk to the system, write in the system, but we don't necessarily have to understand anymore to click here, click there. So the menu-driven interaction that we are very used to, I think, is going to slowly go and put into the background. So for me, that's a more natural way for us. I don't point into your nose or into your ears, do something. That's something we would just communicate, and this you will process it. For me, that's one dimension. The second dimension is really this intent-based interaction that I mentioned before. You're asking for an outcome, and you let the computer or the system ultimately figure out how to achieve that outcome. I personally think we are a little bit further away from the second part. We are slowly getting there, but it's still much more encased in applications than I personally think we will see in a number of years. But the first phase is still important. And Microsoft has been driving this wave together with its partner ecosystem. And we've coined the term copilots. And the copilot is really important because we believe that AI is here to augment human values, human creativity. It's not there to replace it. It's really there to augment it. And therefore, copilot as a term is something that a lot of people have been saying, yes, that really makes a lot of sense to us. And we are.
Can I just, sorry, Uli, can I just stop you there for a second? Because I think, you know, there are so many C-suites and business leaders in general that are sort of, you know, getting challenged with, hey, is this new AI going to come and take my job? Is it going to steal? Are we going to do reductions here and there and so on? And I want to sort of dwell just a second or maybe ask you to elaborate on the amplification part, because I think that's key, right? So when we talk about copilots, we don't talk about replacing, we talk about amplifying. Could you elaborate just a little bit on that?
Let me give you a very, very concrete example. The United States has 4 million people that identify themselves as developers, right? And the world, based upon digital transformation, has expressed the need for 4 million additional developers. So we would have to come up with 8 million people that effectively identify themselves as developers. And there have been really two motions that we are driving. One of them is going after the low-code environment, meaning bringing more people into the environment that are not developers. So again, that's where Power Platform and similar efforts come in. But I think Gen AI is putting up to the next level, which is, hey, how do I go and use AI to augment the developers that I have, meaning make them more productive, make them faster building secure and complex code, and also move from low code to almost no code, which I think is really the two pieces that come together. And here you can see that we now are, on the one side, taking the 4 million developers, make them more productive, make them effectively build better code, better solutions faster. The second one is take even more people that are currently not in the development space, but they are domain experts. They know exactly what supply chain is or field service or whatever. And they can now use these quote unquote no code tools based upon AI to build modern applications. And I think that's really the way I think about it for one community. Another community is security. Take a look at that. There's a lot of security cyber threats going on. And we all know that that's a very, very complex domain. There's not enough people that understand this domain. So now we are using AI in the form of a security copilot to help the people that have to do cybersecurity but are not necessary experts in it, do their job, understand what the threat is, what the incident might be, and how to deal with it. And that's really the way I think about this. So you have a shortage of specific talent, and AI can effectively bring the necessary tools and capabilities to make those capability or those people successful in their job and potentially make out of one, two, three people's jobs. I don't know what the equation really is, but think more of augmenting what people are doing and potentially helping them do new things that they don't necessarily know how to do. If you are a small business, you don't have a cybersecurity expert. So how do you get cybersecurity expertise? Well, AI can help the people that are technology affine to get there.
This is fantastic. And Vijay, just before you comment, I mean, really what I'm taking away is combining vocabulary of experts and very opinionated people, allowing them to work coherently, and also just to, you know, amplifying your most scarce resources. I love that. Vijay, any thoughts from your side on this?
Thanks indeed, Jacob. I'm going to pick up on something Uli said, which is the new conversational interaction allows us naturally to break what used to be previously application silos and data silos. So let's take an example. I work for a pharma major. We've already got a molecule that's gone through discovery phase. It's done lab testing. We already know how to make a pill or a spray out of it. That's drug formulation. And it's now my job to create a few hundred kilograms of this drug so we can do clinical trials. You know, it's pilot scale manufacturing. So now as I'm doing manufacturing, I'm finding that the yield becomes really high at a certain point, but I need the tolerance of temperature or whatever it is to be plus minus 5 degrees. And the researchers said plus minus 2. Now today, I really wouldn't know that I can change things. But if only I can reach upstream, which is no longer a barrier for me, I can get information about all the things the researchers tried and figure out for myself that it's okay to go plus minus 5 degrees. So the key here is, number one, we have a technical breakthrough, which is no longer any barriers between app and data silos. The next thing we really need is to educate people to expand their horizons. So that was really the transformation point.
Yeah. No, this is great, Vijay. And I think, I mean, so I love how you talk about the fact that when scientists and others, they present their hypothesis, they often present a, let's say, an outcome of what they've been working on. But basically what you're saying is that there is an opportunity for the receiving part to keep diving into what is the underlying assumptions of that hypothesis in a much stronger way than before. I think that's an incredible, impactful thing. I want to talk a little bit about collaboration still, because, I mean, Uli, you talked about breaking down silos. You talked about the combining of vocabularies. Vijay, you just talked about, or implied at least, how multiple teams are able to work together. So you both talked about Gen AI and co-pilots, make it possible to, you know, cross disciplines and boundaries. And again, I mean, great examples. So how do you, and this is something that I'm particularly interested in your opinion on, because this is something that we talk with C-suites about all the time. So how do enterprises cultivate a culture of curiosity and crossing processes and discipline boundaries? Because this is not easy. You know, people have been driving their own domains and driving their own kingdoms for years. So how do you instill that culture? Uli, do you want to go first?
Yeah, the way I think about this is you have to give people the opportunity. So one of the things that we have seen people do is deploy copilots to kind of tease people to say, hey, try this AI capability. It's going to help you. And obviously, there's supporting capabilities that you need to deploy, which is training and education and so forth, brown bags, whatever the model is you like as a company. But I think giving people access to this capability is driving the first step towards curiosity. The second thing is to start to really think about how do you look at cross processes. And it's a great example where, for example, our friends from ServiceNow, which is a partner of Microsoft in the IT systems management and process domain, they are building a great Copilot integration where they are saying, hey, people live in Microsoft Teams or in Outlook or something like that. And that's where they normally work and interact. So instead of forcing them into a new user interface, which is specific to a process like purchasing, for example, they are integrating their AI Copilot that helps users with the purchasing process into the Microsoft Teams Copilot. And it becomes a transparent element where the user of the person that is trying to order something doesn't really have to go and understand, oh, no, wait a second, I now need to go over there. And no, what you do is you simply say, hey, I'm trying to order something. And the system then works together to effectively say, ah, in our organization, that means let's bring in the ServiceNow intelligent agent, the Copilot, to help you with the ordering process. And that's another element of what I believe is intent-based interactions. Because you just express intent in the tool that you like, be that an operating system, be that Teams, whatever, and the system will figure out how to bring the right capabilities to you at the right time and help you and guide you through the process. So from my perspective, that's a fantastic example of how two co-pilots, the Microsoft Teams co-pilot and the ServiceNow co-pilot, work together in order to really solve the specific request that a user has. And if you as a company do that consistently and consequently, then I think you will start to have people really understand how all of the assets of a specific enterprise come together to solve business problems or enhance the ability to really drive new business. So this is something that I believe will happen over time more and more, where we will see more skills coming together into a single system. And let's call it the enterprise skills, regardless of where they come from. And that drives integration across silos.
This was a great answer from Uli to my question about how enterprises can cultivate a culture of curiosity. Please join us for part two of this episode when Vijay will share his perspective on that question and more as we wrap this conversation about how copilots can be used to break process and discipline silos. Please join us and thank you for watching the Azure Essentials Show.